I have a feeling that many of you, the choice come down to A or B. The better choice here is choice A, cori plexus papilloma. First of all, this is a pediatric patient, so your differential diagnosis can be based on age. There is a large intraventricular lesion with avid enhancement. The pattern of enhancement is relatively homogeneous. And there is also moderate hydrocephalus. Notice that the lesion is not in the location that can obstruct. Therefore, the hydrocephalus is likely coming from CSF overproduction, which is what cori plexus papilloma can do. The perfusion weighted sequence doesn't really help you when it comes to differential diagnosis between papilloma versus carcinoma, although some textbook would suggest carcinoma have a higher perfusion. This is described as a lobulated or cauliflower-like appearance. Thing that they can ask you about papilloma, first of all, it's grade 1, so it's a low-grade lesion. And they usually come with hydrocephalus, usually due to overproduction. Depending on the location, they can also cause obstruction. They can also have CSF dissemination, and that can also cause obstruction. This is a pediatric disease. Vast majority occur under age of 5. Of course, you can see this in adult. If you have to choose one versus the other, think of this as a pediatric tumor. Unlike other type of pediatric tumor, its common location is in the lateral ventricle, therefore supratentorial. As a kid become older and into adulthood, half of them will be supratentorial, half of them will be infratentorial. So one of the differential diagnoses I see in adult with a forced ventricular, intraventricular tumor, I would think about cori plexus papilloma also. This is an example of another patient with cori plexus papilloma. Very similar to what we see here, with a cauliflower-like appearance, relatively homogeneous avid enhancement with hydrocephalus. This is another example of older patient with biopsy-proven cori plexus papilloma. This time, it is in the fourth ventricle and expanding into the left foramina lusica. It is in the location where you expect to see cori plexus. So let's look at other choices that do not work as well in this case. For choice B, cori plexus carcinoma, or in general, cori plexus tumor as a group, there are three main types. You have papilloma, then you have atypical cori plexus papilloma, and cori plexus carcinoma. All of them tend to occur in kids. So papilloma, of course, is grade 1, grade 2 for atypical papilloma, and grade 3 for carcinoma. You would think that because carcinoma is more aggressive, their image and appearance should be more aggressive compared to papilloma. But in reality, it's often difficult, if not impossible, to make that distinction on imaging alone. So it's reasonable to just call them as a group cori plexus tumor. There are some features that will make you lean more heavily toward carcinoma, such as parenchymal invasion. This is an example of biopsy-proven carcinoma in a young kid, a large intraventricular tumor that's a little bit more heterogeneous compared to papilloma. There's more central cystic changes. More importantly, there's focal parenchymal invasion, as you can see. So when you see that, you can lean toward carcinoma as opposed to papilloma. Cori plexus carcinoma also come with hydrocephalus, although in my experience with limited sample, they tend not to produce as much hydrocephalus as papilloma, probably due to the fact that they do not produce CSF like papilloma would. Their hydrocephalus tend to occur with obstruction, either due to hemorrhage or due to leptomeningeal disease downstream. Other choice here, for example, choice C, intraventricular meningioma. It should look like meningioma elsewhere. So there's a homogeneous enhancement, avid enhancement. Sometimes it can calcify. And this is an adult disease. It's relatively uncommon to see intraventricular meningioma in kids. And because it does not have CSF overproduction capability, and they tend not to have leptomeningeal metastasis, you don't expect to see hydrocephalus unless it's in the location that can cause obstruction. Another adult disease is subependymoma. And this is a good board exam question in that many of the intraventricular mass tend to enhance quite avidly. So the fact that key signature of subependymoma is that they tend not to enhance or enhance very little, that's relatively unique among intraventricular neoplasm. Typically, they occur in the lateral ventricle, and often they are incidental findings. Subependymoma that I see usually comes in with other reasons such as headache, or maybe patient was in a car accident that they did a CT, and they incidentally describe an intraventricular mass. And this is an adult disease, so again, age is important when you prioritize your differential diagnosis. Lastly, subependymal giant cell astrocytoma. For this, you should see other findings that associate tuberous sclerosis, such as cortical and subcortical tuber and other subependymal nodule. It is very uncommon to see a subependymal giant cell astrocytoma in a patient that does not have tuberous sclerosis. And the key feature is that greater than 1 centimeter, and it's usually around the foramen row, so therefore they can cause obstruction. This is a kid's disease in that they tend to occur in young patients with tuberous sclerosis. That is all for this Cori plexus papilloma. Thanks for your attention and good luck on your board exam.